The deadly and destructive Second World War has just concluded. The invasions of the Normandy beaches killed more than 200,000 troops, as the dropping of the atomic bombs on the Japanese towns of Hiroshima and Nagasaki killed nearly 200,000. But even though those bombs ended World War, they would start a new one, a political standoff to ensue between Joseph Stalin of the Soviet Union and Harry S. Truman of the United States. This was, as we know it as today, the Cold War. World War II is just ended as the atomic bombs are dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. The Allied leaders meet at the Potsdam Conference, where they negotiate the territories claimed within the former borders of Germany during the war. As the conference concludes and the Soviet Union walks away with the set border, Soviet leader Joseph Stalin appears to be unsatisfied. And immediately following the conference, he and the Soviets begin placing pro-communist governments in not only Poland, but also Hungary, Bulgaria, Czechoslovakia, Romania, Albania, and even spreading them into eastern Germany. In defense of the spreading of communist propaganda, U.S. President Harry Truman utilizes a new strategy, containment, to make sure communist ideas don't spread farther into Western Europe. And after trying so hard to stay out of European affairs, President Truman is eventually forced to pass both the Truman Doctrine in 1947, which promised that the U.S. would aid other democratic governments facing the threat of communist overthrow, and the Marshall Plan, also in 1947, which aided billions of dollars to eliminate the possibility of a communist takeover because of political and financial instability. Then, everything changed in 1948. The Soviet Union blocked the roads leading and coming from Berlin, making it impossible for the once German-led city to receive shipments from the ground. In retaliation, both the United States and Great Britain pulled off a mind-blowing airlift mission to supply the blocked-off city with food, water, and other essential supplies. And after 231 grueling days of air shipments, the Soviet Union finally opens the city back up to Western Europe. Following the opening of Berlin, the United States joins the North American Trade Agreement, also known as NATO, marking the first time ever in American history where the country joined a security and a military alliance. The year is 1950. U.S. National Security Report NSC-68 further repeats President Harry Truman's statement that the country could use any weapons necessary to handle any communist issue anywhere in the world. The arms race commences in 1945 with the U.S. dropping of the atomic bombs on the towns of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. While the United States is continuing to develop more weapons like the ones used to end World War II, the Soviet Union tries to develop their own. And in 1949, they did. After the Soviets' testing, the United States then announces they would be developing even more destructive and powerful bomb, the hydrogen bomb. Joseph Stalin did the same, and in November of 1952, the United States conducts the first ever testing of the H-bomb. Detonated in Iwatuk Atoll, the H-bomb created a 25-square-mile fireball. It vaporized a nearby island, created a huge hole in the ocean floor, and created enough force that it could destroy half of the island of Manhattan in New York if it was near it. In fear of possible nuclear war, some civilians began constructing their own bomb shelters and stocked up on food and water. schools also combated this possibility of nuclear warfare by instructing students and teachers on how to safely prepare for a possible air attack. Dwight D. Eisenhower is now president of the United States. In October of the year 1957, the Soviet Union successfully launches Sputnik 1, the first ever satellite and man-made object to be sent to the final frontier we call space. In the following year, the United States launched their own satellite, Explorer 1, into Earth's orbit. This was the commencement of the space race. Just a couple of months later, President Eisenhower signed the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, also known as NASA, into commission, making it known that America was now going to take this seriously. America is now on to its 35th president, John Fitzgerald Kennedy, and both the states and the Soviets are still strategizing in their own ways on how to send a living, breathing human into the vacuum of space and return them safely. In 1961, the Soviet Union did this. Soviet military pilot and cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin became the first human to go to space and to orbit the Earth on April 12, 1961. The following month, the United States sent their own Alan Shepard, making him the first American to complete an orbit around the Earth. In the days following America's historic achievement, President John F. Kennedy boldly declared that the United States would be the country to send humans to the moon. And by boldly, he meant by the end of the decade.
We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things. Not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
Kennedy did not live to see it, but on July 20th, 1969, American astronauts Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin became the first humans to walk on the moon. On the rock, the astronauts set up laser reflectors, planted the American flag into the lunar surface, and left a plaque reading, "Here men from the planet Earth first set foot on the moon, July 1969 AD. We came in peace for all mankind." The Apollo 11 moon landing was not only a win for the US in the space race, but an historic achievement for all of the human race. Cuba, 1962. The Soviet Union has set up nuclear missile sites on the island, unknown to America's knowledge. October 14, an American U-2 spy plane flies over Cuba, and the pilot, Major Richard Hazer, notices the missile sites. He photographs them. President Kennedy is informed 2 days after the initial discovery, and he immediately organizes an executive committee. And 8 days after discovery, he informs the nation.
Good evening, my fellow citizens. This government, as promised, has maintained the closest surveillance of the Soviet military buildup on the island of Cuba. Within the past week, unmistakable evidence has established the fact that a series of offensive missile sites is now in preparation on that imprisoned island. The purpose of these bases can be none other than to provide a nuclear strike capability against the Western Hemisphere. Upon receiving the first preliminary hard information of this nature, last Tuesday morning at 9 a.m., I directed that our surveillance be stepped up.
American surveillance was stepped up. Kennedy and his committee decide to quarantine the island of Cuba and form a blockade around it with the help of the U.S. Navy. Now, the Soviets cannot import or export any supplies. Chances of a nuclear war became more likely on October 27th. An American reconnaissance plane, piloted by Major Rudolph Anderson, was shot down over Cuba. He was killed. A U.S. invasion team was assembled in Florida as a nuclear war seemed almost inevitable. But Soviet leader Nikita Khrushchev sent a letter directly to President Kennedy. Khrushchev offered to disassemble the missiles and bring them back to Russia, and so he did. And in a separate agreement, the United States removed their missiles, which were stationed in Turkey. On October 28, 1962, the Cuban Missile Crisis ended, and the possible start of a nuclear war was prevented. November 22nd, 1963. John F. Kennedy and First Lady Jacqueline Kennedy arrive at Love Field in Dallas, Texas. They are greeted with an overwhelming sight of cheering fans and supporters as their motorcade, with Texas Governor John Connally and his wife on board, drive through the streets of Dallas. As they drive through Dealey Plaza, three shots are fired from the sixth floor window of the Texas School Book Depository building. The motorcade speeds off to nearby Parkland Hospital in a desperate rush to try and save the 35th president. Then, at 2:38 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, CBS News' Walter Cronkite delivers the message.
From Dallas, Texas, the flash, apparently official, President Kennedy died at 1 p.m. Central Standard Time. 2 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, some 38 minutes ago.
Lyndon B. Johnson is sworn in as the 36th President of the United States on board Air Force One. Kennedy's alleged assassin, Lee Harvey Oswald, is arrested hours later. More than 250,000 mourning citizens crowd the sides of the streets in Washington, D.C., wanting to bid farewell to their president. After lying in state at the Capitol, JFK was buried in Arlington National Cemetery on the 25th. His brother and his widow lit an eternal flame at his burial site. His alleged assassin was fatally shot at point-blank range while being transferred to another jail. Oswald's killer, nightclub owner Jack Ruby, was charged with first-degree murder but died of cancer before he could get tried in court. Texas Governor John Connally was seriously injured after being shot in the back during Kennedy's assassination, but survived. As for the First Lady, she passed away in 1994 due to non-Hodgkin lymphoma. 1989. The Berlin Wall falls due to infrastructure issues. West and East Germany are finally united after years of separation. In 1991, Gorbachev resigns as the leader of the Soviet Union, and days later, it officially collapses. The last hammer and sickle flag is lowered at the Kremlin and replaced with the present-day Russian tricolor flag. In the days following, the once Soviet territories join existing countries such as Azerbaijan and the Ukraine, or become their own republics. These past 45 years of destructive weapons, the inevitability of nuclear war, the race for who brings humans into space, and a crisis on an island will from now on be known as the Cold War.